Good morning.
Good morning.
God's grace and peace to you. Today is our annual meeting immediately following worship. So those of you who are visiting with us at the benediction, feel free to leave. But the rest of the folks are going to sit down for a brief annual meeting and a report. Are there other announcements that I need to make? Well, let us prepare our hearts to worship God. Please remain standing for our call to worship. Why are we here?
We are here to praise God.
We are here to be strengthened in our faith.
We are here to listen to God's word.
We are here to be challenged in our discipleship.
We are here to pray.
We are here to sing praises to God.
We are here to respond to God's call on our lives.
We are here to draw close to God and God's people.
We are here to be transformed.
We are here to worship.
Let us join together as one in Christ to worship God.
Please remain standing as we sing God is Here, verses 1 and 4.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Some of us break the rules for right living and know we are sinners. Others keep all the rules but realize that our relationships with God and others are not really as they should be. Some of us think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Others do not appreciate our own worth as God's children, nor live in the confidence of God's love. Most of us, when faced with a choice between security and venturing into dangerous, unknown paths where God may be calling us, are reluctant to take the risk of faith. All we are, recognizing how unworthy we approach the one who embraces the universe, yet believing that we are known and welcomed in his awesome presence. Let us confess our sin. This morning I will say a line or a phrase and then I'll leave time for silence. Let us pray. O Lord, hear our prayers as we confess the rules for right living that we have broken. Forgive our mistakes in relating to others. Help us to see ourselves as you see us. Give us the courage we need to invest in your service. O Lord, show us what you would have us do. Forgive us when we have fallen short of your will for our lives. O Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. God remembers our sins no more.
Accept God's forgiveness.
In Christ, we are given a new life.
We will live as people of grace, forgiven and renewed. Alleluia.
You may be seated. Would the children come forward? Good morning. How are you doing today?
Good.
You all right? Look what I brought today.
Play-Doh.
Have you ever played with Play-Doh?
Me.
You have? You have? Have you ever played with it? What do you like to make out of Play-Doh?
Pancakes.
Pancakes. What else?
Dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs.
Snakes.
Yes. That is fun. The Bible tells us that to be like Jesus, our hearts have to be like Play-Doh. Now that sounds funny, doesn't it? But we sang, just a sec, Davis, we sang about it. We said, change my heart, O God, make it ever new. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Mold me and make me. And we're talking about inside. We want God to shape our hearts to be more like Jesus, just like as if it was Play-Doh. Now, what happens, have any of you ever had Play-Doh and you left the lid off or you left it out? What happens to Play-Doh if you leave it out? It dries up and you can't use it anymore, can you? It's not moldable. That can happen to our hearts, too. The Bible says, do not harden your hearts. Do not harden your hearts. We want our hearts to be open, open to God and God's love. Will you pray with me? And then I have Play-Doh for you to take.
Yay!
Will you pray? Catch your legs. Pull your ears. Tap your shoulders, rub your hands together, fold them, and let's pray. You say it after me. Dear God,
dear God,
mold us and make us.
Mold us and make us.
Open to you and your love.
Open to you and your love.
Make us more like Jesus.
Make us more like Jesus.
Help our hearts to say soft.
Help our hearts to say soft.
And not hard and closed. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus'
name.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, wait just a sec. I'll get the Play-Doh. Thank you.
bow our heads with a prayer for illumination. Lord our God, this morning we seek the illumination of the Holy Spirit as on our worship hour. Let our prayer, song, and recited readings be the light by which we walk this week. Through your word from the Old and New Testaments, speak to us in our pastor's message. May all be your glory and for our spiritual growth. We do pray these things in the name of and for the sake of Jesus the Christ, our risen Lord and only Savior. Amen. Our Old Testament reading is Psalms 95, and it is a responsive reading. Listen now for the word of God. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land which his hands have formed. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
The New Testament lesson, the first one is found in Philippians 2, 9 to 11. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, and in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And then from Ephesians 3, 18 to 21, listen for God's word. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. O gracious God, I ask that you would open our hearts that we might hear your word for us, that we might be inspired to worship, that we might be inspired for more faithful living. This we pray. Amen. One of the problems with worship today at our church and in other churches of many denominations is the lack of wonder, the lack of amazement, and the lack of surprise. I mean, it's as if God and the nearness of God has become expected and assumed. We have become so comfortable with a God who is our friend, almost buddy-buddy, that we have ceased to approach God with trepidation. Presbyterian pastor Don McCullough wrote a wonderful book whose title sums up what I'm talking about. It's called The Trivialization of God. The book begins with the observation about modern worship. Visit a church on a Sunday morning, almost any will do, and you will likely find a congregation comfortably relating to a deity who fits nicely within precise doctrinal positions, or who lends almighty support to social crusades, or who conforms to individual spiritual experiences. But you will not likely find much awe or sense of mystery. The only sweaty palms will be those of the preacher, unsure as to whether the sermon will go over, and the only shaking knees will be those of the soloist about to sing the offertory. You know, Don has a point. Maybe our problem is not just our view or expectation of God. Maybe part of the problem is our expectation or view of worship. Annie Dillard has been often quoted on the same point. She writes in Teaching a Stone to Talk, "Why do people in churches seem like cheerful, brainless tourists on a package tour of the absolute? On the whole, I do not find Christians outside the catacombs sufficiently sensible of conditions. Does anyone have the foggiest idea what sort of power we so blithely invoke? It is madness to wear ladies' hats in church. We should all be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews, for the sleeping God may awake someday and take offense. Or the waking God may return and draw us out to where we can never return." Powerful words. The message is the same. We have become complacent when we come to worship. We come to worship a complacent God, a God who is content. And I believe that God is not content. Not content to just let things slide. Not content with our response to his call. Not content with our world. Okay, let's switch gears a minute and talk about how some of us talk about worship. When leaving worship, many a family may discuss over Sunday dinner conversations that go something like this. "Well, how was worship today?" "Oh, pretty good. The minister told a funny story, and I love the anthem that the choir sang. It was one of my favorites." Now, this view of worship is one where worship is critiqued for its entertainment value. Worship does indeed entertain, but if that is all it does, if that is its only value, then we are sorely in need of better. To view worship as entertainment is a concept that's far too trivial. Worship can and should be much more. Another way that worship is viewed is through judging the experience in terms of whether or not it promotes psychological and spiritual healing. Does it make me feel better? Did it bring healing to my life? But as Michael Lindvall puts it, there is, of course, a sense in which worship must do just that. But to understand it so, as such, simply reduces the worship of God to something much smaller. Somewhere along the line, worship became viewed as an educational endeavor, one that teaches us through instructive sermons those seeking spiritual and intellectual improvement. Christians should learn in worship the stories of Jesus and the teachings of Christ. But if that is all it is, we could watch a video or read a book for some information. Worship is educational, but that is too small of a category to comprehend the fullness of worship. Now, maybe none of these is the purpose of worship. Worship does entertain, it does heal, it does teach, but none of these is the purpose. Worship at its best shakes us up and refocuses our attention, not on ourselves, but on God. Linville writes, "Worship is nothing less than an attempt to set the order of creation aright. The creature owns his creaturehood. Honest confession is spoken. Praise is offered. The worshiper surrenders his pretense to be a god. All turn in adoration to the one who is God." In this dramatic enactment of the fundamental rightness of things lies transformation and restoration. Life edges into proper balance. We are free to be who we are, no more, but no less. We discover the liberation that comes with being forgiven and accepted by both God and neighbor. We are freed from the pretense of autonomy and invulnerability. We no longer imagine that we are in control of everything. Worship is no less than a weekly rehearsal for the right order of things. That is true for some of you. In fact, some of you have said, if you don't come to worship, then the week just doesn't feel right. I think that's the way of saying that they're missing the proper balance that Linville spoke about. What is it about worship that helps us recapture our balance? Often in worship, we acknowledge that we are not in control. We can't control our children, our neighbors, or even our pets. We are not in control of how our medical test will come out. We are not in control. In worship, we admit that we do not live up to our own standards or to God's standards. We confess that we neglect to do the things we should and that we do things that we regret. That weekly realization helps us get a better picture of reality. It helps us find our place in the universe. In worship, we recognize who made us and who we belong to. We name God as the creator of our world and Jesus Christ as our Savior. And we name the power of the Holy Spirit on which we claim and rely. In worship, we can evaluate our priorities and commune with God. Worship helps us regain our balance. Listen to these questions regarding worship, rather than how was worship, which might lead to a critique of the Sunday service, oh, the mics weren't right. But other questions might include, what did you lose in worship? What burden did you leave at the cross? What gnawing anger are you going home without? What lie do you no longer believe? We tend to view worship like a performance. with the minister and the choir as the actors, with the congregation as the audience, and with God as the prompter. But about 170 years ago, a famous theologian, Soren Kierkegaard, observed that we church folk suffer from role confusion in worship. Role confusion in worship. Kierkegaard said that we would do better if we viewed the congregation as the actors, as with God as the audience, and the minister and the choir as the prompters. Linval reminds us that each Sunday we have the opportunity to come face to face with God, to give ourselves to God, to lose ourselves in God, and to turn away from self and recenter on God. When we do that, worship is meaningful. It is full of awe, veneration, and admiration. When we do that, we find ourselves back in balance. In a desire to recenter ourselves, may we approach worship with the reminder of which way we are facing. May we turn toward God, focusing on the Almighty, that we might see ourselves and others more clearly as we leave. Amen and amen. I invite you to stand and let us affirm our faith. Let us say what we believe. We believe in the one God, maker and ruler of all things, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher and redeemer, the Savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God contained in the Old and New Testaments as a sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the church, the group of believers who are united to the living Lord. The church worships God together and serves in God's name the hurting world. We believe in the kingdom of God as the divine rule in human society. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We come to a time of our morning for our morning offering, a time to give back, a time to give, rededicating ourselves, our resources, our very lives, our morning offering.
Treasures and fame, true.
Please join me in our prayer of dedication. God, our Creator, take these gifts that we bring and use us and them to bring about your purposes in this world. We are grateful to you for your love and are challenged by your call to discipleship. Make us more faithful in our love for you and in our response to others. May we always model your grace. Amen.